Good morning, Bethesda. We welcome you here on this Palm Sunday. We have a lot of stuff going on and happening in the next couple of weeks, and so we invite you to check out the screens, see all the stuff going on here.
Good morning, Bethesda. Let me share with you some ways to serve and get connected. And as always, you can find out even more at BethesdaCommunityChurch.com. The Easter Holy Week schedule can be found online, but very briefly, the Good Friday service is this coming Friday, and if you'd like a spot at the Seder meal, which is served right afterwards, you need to know that today is the last day that you can register. Also, just a reminder that next Sunday is Easter Sunday morning, and we will have two services, one at 9 a.m. and the other at 11 a.m. And then lastly, our Bethesda Kids team has put together a fantastic 8-day devotional kit for our families, and today's the last day to grab one of those kits because today is the first day to share the very first devotion. So please pick up those kits today, wherever you pick up your child. And of course, everybody grab some Easter invite cards and a yard sign if there are any left. Fill your pulpits and invite people to encounter Jesus with us on Easter Sunday morning. Do the words falafel, dink, and flapjack mean anything to you? Does your heart sink when you think about a nasty Nelson or a Vali Lama? If so, you're invited to participate in Rory's first pickleball tournament on Friday, April the 12th, beginning at 6 p.m. in our Bethesda gym. The cost is $100 a team, and all the proceeds will go to the purchase of some brand new Lion crash mats for our gym walls. Who can play? All right, teams of two, 8 years old and up is highly recommended. So grab a friend, grab a family member, grab a student, and come enjoy this round robin tournament. You're guaranteed to play at least two games, and the top two teams will win a prize. If you're not a pickleball player, you can still come and hang out. The concession stand will be open, and good conversation will be had by all. Register by April the 5th while spots are still available. Our next Parent University is especially for our young families. It's Wednesday, April the 17th at 6:30 p.m. in the sanctuary, and it's covering the birds and the bees. We've got a very special guest speaker, Megan Mickelson, coming to train us so that we can better train our kids. This is a great resource, guys. Parents, do not miss it. Childcare is available. The cost is $10. More information is online. Seriously, this is gonna be some fantastic and very practical help for all of our families with young kids, so get signed up. I've got two quick reminders for you. First of all, if you enjoy McAllister's restaurant, please consider eating there tomorrow night on the 25th of March at the North Richland Hills or the Alliance locations from 5 o'clock until 10 o'clock. All you gotta do is let the cashier know that you are there to support Bethesda Christian School, and then you can order your humongous giant potato with bacon and cheese and ranch and chives and more bacon, and or you can get a salad. Either way. BCS receives 20% of the sales, so thanks in advance. Also, Youth Camp, it's coming up June 10th through the 14th. The early bird price ends this Wednesday, March 27th, so please sign up for that as soon as possible. And then, of course, Elementary Kids Camp is also coming up. It's July 24th through the 27th, and that early bird price doesn't expire until April 30th, but either way, please sign up. Okay, parents, let's be intentional this week in having spiritual conversations with our children. We want them to understand the sacrifice that Jesus made for us, because that is the very best news of all. All right, I hope this helps you find a place to serve and connect. For more information on these events and every other thing that's going on at Bethesda, please visit BethesdaCommunityChurch.com.
Thank you. God's word from Psalm 118. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. For his steadfast love endures forever. Let Israel say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let the house of Aaron say, his steadfast love endures forever. Let those who fear the Lord say, his steadfast love endures forever. The Lord is my strength and my song. He has become my salvation. Glad songs of salvation are in the tents of the righteous. Open to me the gates of righteousness, that I may enter through them and give thanks to the Lord. This is the gate of the Lord. The righteous shall enter through it. I thank you that you have answered me and you have become my salvation. The stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone. This is the Lord's doing, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Hallelujah. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Save us, we pray, O Lord. O Lord, we pray, give us success. We bless you from the house of the Lord. The Lord, he is God, and he has made his light to shine upon us. You are my God, and I will give thanks to you. You are my God, I will extol you. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, and his steadfast love endures forever. Bethesda, this is the word of the Lord.
Bless the name of the Lord. Oh, bless the name of the Lord. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Come on, y'all. Clap your hands. We're going to lift up every praise because he's worthy.
Yeah.
to him in this house today. Come on, somebody lift up a Hosanna in this house today. Praise is rising, eyes are turning to you. We turn to you. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning. I want you to lift up. When we see,
we find strength to face the day.
Yes, in your presence, Lord.
In your presence, all our fears are
washed away.
Come
on. Sing it out.
Hosanna,
Hosanna,
Hosanna.
You are the Somebody lift it in your presence, Lord.
In your presence, all our fears are washed away.
Sing it again. When we see,
we find strength
to face
the day.
In your presence, Lord.
In your presence, all our fears are washed away.
They're washed away. Come on, lift it.
Hosanna.
Somebody lift it to him. Lift your praise to him. Hosanna, when we see you, we find strength to face the day. Because in your presence, all our fears are washed away. Lift it. Because when we see you, we find strength to face the day. Yes, we.
And in your presence, all our fears are washed away.
I want you to sing it one more time. When we see you, Lord,
when we see you, we find strength to face the day.
In your presence, Lord.
Because in your presence, all our fears are washed away.
They're washed away.
Hosanna.
Jesus, we welcome you here, Lord Jesus. Be enthroned in the praises of your people. Be enthroned in the praises of your people. We long for you, we love you, we give you our praise, Lord. We thank you, Jesus. Lord, we thank you for your presence in here today. We thank you for gathering with us, meeting us. We know that your word is true, and when we gather, you gather with us. You are here in the midst of us. We thank you this morning that as we praise, as we declare our worship, that you are faithfully moving, you're faithfully healing, you are working. We give you thanks, Jesus. Anybody just want to give him thanks for who he is?
There is strength in the name of the Lord. There is power in the name of the Lord. There is hope in the name of the Lord.
Blessed is he.
Blessed is he who comes
in the name of the Lord.
Will you lift it? Come on, sing it.
There is strength in the name of the Lord. There is power in the name of the Lord.
Do you believe it?
There is hope in the name of the Lord.
Blessed is he.
Blessed is he who comes
in the name
of the Lord.
Lift it up. Sing it, sing it.
There is.
Serve an awesome God. Hallelujah. We praise your holy name. We lift your name high. Oh, you know this song, I want you to help us sing.
My God is awesome. He can move mountains, keep me in the valley. Where I've been weakened, forever he will reign.
And so much more. We sing the song and the prayer of faith this morning, believing that you can move mountains. believe that you can provide, that you can protect, that you will defend, that you will guard, that you will guide, that you will heal, that you will restore. Jesus, we love you. Can we just tell him how much we love him? Let's just fill this room with our praise for a minute. Come on, just give him a praise. Give him an audible praise. Begin to speak out a praise to him. Call on the name of Jesus. Aren't you grateful to be in his presence? Turn and greet someone around you. Welcome someone to the house of the Lord this morning.
Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Whew. Weren't those kids cute earlier? I presume they're yours. If not, take one home with you. They were super cute. All right. I heard that. He said, careful, careful. Hey, just want to welcome you guys to the house of the Lord on this very, very important day in the church calendar. We have come to lift up the name of the Lord and remember all that he has done. This is exactly where we need to be. Guests, if you're online watching, you're with us. Everybody here in pews, you're obviously with us. We're so happy to be able to worship with you. If you are a guest, there's some cards. They look like this. If you fill them out, we will reach out to you promptly. Unless your name is Gabby or Angel. I found these in my bag yesterday. I'm sorry. So Gabby and Angel, if you're here, I'm going to be reaching out to you this week. I usually don't forget. I think I hurt my back the day after I got these, and I did not remember, so I apologize. But if you fill that out, we'll reach out to you because we just want to be able to welcome you and then also to worship with you and help you connect in places. And so we don't make it any more than it is, just to reach. And so if you'd like to do that, fill out those cards, drop it off at the hub. If you have any questions, all of us, the hub's a great place to go. All right, before we pray for our tithes and offerings, I want to recognize a couple in our church. They've been here for many years. Romans 13:7 says, pay to all what is owed. If it's taxes, then pay the taxes. If it's tribute or revenue, pay the revenue. If it's respect, if it's fear, if it's honor, then pay that. And so today, I would like to not focus on the taxes part, because I think you might get yourself in trouble if you do the taxes part, but the respect and the honor part. I'd like to have Clayton and Lori Stockdahl stand wherever they are. Where are you at, Clayton? There they are. For many, many years, 12 to be exact, Clayton and Lori have been leading and many times speaking in one of our Sunday morning classes, and this was their last Sunday to do that. They will find other ways to serve and other ways to minister. This is their last time, and so I wanted us to take this chance and just recognize them and honor them. Thank y'all for your faithful service. And Eric and Susan Hewlett, who are celebrating their 51st anniversary today down in the Hill Country. They're probably watching online right now. They are going to fill in, and you can't replace good people, but they are also good people. And so that class meets right over here, and we'd love for you guys, if you need a place to learn and to grow on a Sunday morning, that's a great place for you. So Lord Jesus, we thank you for all that you've done in our lives. We thank you that you've done things in our lives that are worth honoring and worth respecting, because I know we play our part in that equation, but it's a small part. You do all the heavy lifting, and you do that in us. And so when we recognize it, we want to encourage others and recognize it in them, but we always want to point right back to you and just say, it's because of you, it's because of your favor, it's because of your strength, it's because of your grace that we can even have something that's worth anything to offer. And so, Lord, we bring it to you. We also bring our tithes and our offerings. However we gave, it's fine. But we bring them to you just saying, Lord, you're the Lord of our life. You're the Lord of our finances. We ask that you bless them. And we ask you to keep on blessing them. And we ask that you would pour into those who, as we're faithful with our finances, you pour into and protect, just like you promised you would in Malachi 3. And multiply. Lord, trust us with more. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
if you know that God has made a way. Amen. Amen.
Oh, yeah, you made a way. Don't know how, but you did it. You made a way. Standing here, not knowing how we'll get through this test, but holding on to faith you know best. Nothing can catch you by surprise. You've got this figured out. You're watching us now. As if we can't win, you wrap us in your arms and you step in, and everything we need you supply. You've got this in control, and now we know that you made a way. When our backs were against the wall and it looked as if it was over, you made a way. And we're standing here only because you made a way. You made a way. Oh, now we're on where we've come from, but because of you and nothing that we've done, to deserve the love and mercy you've shown. Your grace is strong enough to pick us up. You
made a way
when our back was
against the wall.
Don't know how.
Don't know how,
but you did it.
Whoa, you did it.
I'm standing here in faith, I believe. Yes, I'm standing here. Oh, yes, I'm standing here. Somebody needs to proclaim it. Thank God I'm standing here. Yes, I'm standing. No matter what the doctor said, hey, I'm standing here. No matter how many times the enemy tried to take me out, yes, I'm standing here. Oh, yeah. Yes, I'm standing here. Standing in your presence. Yes, I'm standing here. I'm believing, I'm trusting. Oh, I'm standing here. Oh, yes, I'm standing here only because you made a way.
Will somebody lift up a hallelujah in this house today? Didn't you love to see the kids come down the aisles? I know Pastor Josh already mentioned it, but it brought back memories of when I was a child, and we always had a palm parade like that. And I asked my mom this week, I said, Mom, isn't there a picture of me somewhere carrying a palm about Beckham's age? And she sent it to me, and I almost put it on the screen, but oh no, nobody needs to see all that, but it's a little, you know, self-serving, I mean, or something, I don't know. But I'll email it to you if you ask me, yeah. thanks, Victor. But I watched them come down, and they were joyful and waving those palms, and it's just a reminder that those precious little ones who are waving those palm branches and who are shouting Hosanna, they're not encumbered by all of the things that encumber us. They don't,
their world is different than ours, and it's a pure praise as they're coming down that aisle, and it was wonderful. Well, today is Palm Sunday. We've been talking about the time is now for worship, and Pastor Wayman gave us a message three Sundays ago about the woman who anointed Jesus, and if you remember that, I want to smell like Jesus. Pastor Marty preached from Isaiah in the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord. She talked about worship brilliantly from that passage. Pastor Josh last week, my goodness, Pastor Josh. Talked about following the Lord and how that's an act of worship. Talked about us getting up our sails, catching the wind of the Holy Spirit where he's blowing, and following the Lord is an act of worship. I'm going to attempt something today that takes us through the events of the first Palm Sunday, the day or two before, leading into Palm Sunday, and then the day or so after. Janice and I were with Pastor Wayman and Kimberly on Friday. We'd been invited to a banquet, and so we had gone over, and they were going to ride with us, and that was unplanned, but we all got in the same car, and Pastor Wayman said, how's your sermon coming for Sunday? And I said, it's great. Not really, but it's going to be great. And I said, I have 11 points. And he said, okay. And then Kimberly said from the back of the truck, she said, well, Wayman, you had 7 on. He said, I did. And he said, you know, Brent, you could either cut one and be 10, like the 10 commandments, or you could add a point and have 12, like the 12 disciples. And I was getting the drift that 11 probably wasn't a good number. So I cut one, and I have 10 points to this message today. Don't worry. We're not going to get to 1 o'clock or 2 o'clock, I promise. I'm not going to spend a long time, but I do have 10 points. This morning, I said something to the worship team. I said, let's not spin anything out. Let's just get it. I got 10 points in my message. I was kind of joking. And Noel, our guitar player, said, oh, it's Palm Sunday. So you have 10 points on Palm Sunday. I missed a really great opportunity to have a great sermon title with something along those lines. But the title of my message today is Worship Fit for a King. I should say Worship Fit for the King. Today is Palm Sunday, as you know. Some people call it Passion Sunday. It is kicking us off into Holy Week, the last week of Jesus' life. And it's an important day. In fact, so important that I really did not want to speak on this day. I just didn't feel like I could bring anything to the topic that was worthy of it. But as I started piecing together, I got more and more excited, because what I'm going to attempt to do is tell you the story of that first Palm Sunday, but also talk about worship all throughout, because we have been talking about the time is now for worship. And so I want to put this together. I am going to be reading today out of the Message. Now, I know that is not everyone's favorite paraphrase or translation. It's probably not recommended that pastors preach from that only on a particular Sunday, but I am not parsing anything here. I'm not diving into the Greek or the Hebrew of the Scriptures. I want to tell you the story. I love telling stories, and I just want to tell you the story. And I want to set this up to say, this was an amazing time in Jerusalem. It's Passover, and Jesus has just raised Lazarus. Now, Jesus had raised Jairus' daughter, but if you'll recall, when Jesus went and raised Jairus' daughter, he sent everybody out of the room. There were just a few people in the room, and he did that miracle, and then he said, Don't go tell anyone. But as we're moving toward this last week of his life, he's getting more open about it. And he raises Lazarus in front of a lot of people. And everyone's beginning to take notice. Everyone's beginning to talk about this. And his name is kind of getting spread around. And the religious leaders are just, infuriated because of this popularity. And so we find Jesus and his disciples and a larger crowd of his followers traveling toward Jerusalem for this Passover. Passover is one of the three compulsory feasts, and those Jews who were near, Jews within 15 miles, they would have had to travel to Jerusalem to be a part of it, but Jews from all over would have just been excited to be there for at least one Passover. It was a dream, and the first century historian Josephus tells us that it was probably somewhere between 2.5 and 2.7 million people that descended on Jerusalem during this Passover, during this first triumphal entry, during this first Palm Sunday. Now, I want you to think about that. There's less than a square mile. There's probably between 25 and 35,000 people is the population of Jerusalem at this point. Now, Rome had counted it a lot larger, but most scholars and historians believe it was really about 25 to 35,000 people. Today, the population of Jerusalem is 900,000, and the boundaries have extended, of course, out of the old city. It's 48 square miles or 252 square miles for the larger area, so it can accommodate more people, but this little area with 2.5 million people that have descended upon it for Passover, it's crowded. There's a lot of stuff going on there. The crowds are going. People are noticing Jesus. And you know who else is noticing Jesus? The Pharisees. They've noticed Jesus. They're trying to figure out, is he coming? Will he be coming? And this is where we find ourselves as we enter the story. Jesus has become a wanted man. He's a wanted man. But he's traveling toward Jerusalem. I am speaking today out of all four Gospels. Other than the feeding of the 5,000, and some even debate this, it was the feeding of the multitude, did it happen more than once? So this is debated, but that could possibly be the first major activity that was recorded in all four Gospels. But after that, this, the triumphal entry of Jesus, is the first major event that is now recorded in all four Gospels. And what I've done is I've tried to piece each moment together. Where did Jesus go? Where did he move next? What did he say next? So just go on the story with me, okay? And I'm going to start in Matthew. The scripture will be on the screen. If you want to take notes, you can. There will be scripture references, so you can go and look at all of this later. But I'm going to start in Matthew. And so Jesus was now well on the way up to Jerusalem. He took the 12 off to the side of the road, and he said, "Listen to me carefully. We are on our way up to Jerusalem. When we get there, the Son of Man will be betrayed to the religious leaders and scholars. They will sentence him to death. They will then hand him over to the Romans for mockery and torture and crucifixion. And on the third day, he will be raised up alive." Wow. He tells them right there, here's what we're doing. It was about that time that the mother of the Zebedee brothers came with her two sons and knelt before Jesus with a request. Now, who is the mother of the sons of Zebedee, James and John? Well, it's possibly Salome, who a lot of scholars and historians believe could have been the sister of Mary, the mother of Jesus. So if this is Salome and her sons are James and John, she's an aunt to Jesus, and she's got a couple of boys here. And interestingly, she's on the trip with them. It was about that time that the mother of the Zebedee brothers came with her two sons and knelt before Jesus with a request. Now that's a posture of worship there. She knelt, some versions say she knelt respectfully in front of Jesus with a request. "What do you want?" Jesus asked. She said, "Give your word that these two sons of mine will be awarded the highest places of honor in your kingdom, one at your right hand and one at your left hand." Jesus responded, "You have no idea what you're asking." And he said to James and John, "Are you capable of drinking the cup that I'm about to drink?" And they said, "Sure. Why not?" He had just told them, "The Son of Man will be betrayed to the religious leaders and scholars. They'll sentence him to death. They're going to hand him over to the Romans for mockery and torture and crucifixion." And they say, "Sure. Why not?" It's because they didn't get it. And Jesus said, "Come to think of it, you are going to drink my cup. But as to awarding places of honor, that's not my business. My Father is taking care of that. Now, interestingly, there are places of honor. But he says, that's not my business. And when the 10 others heard about this, they lost their tempers. Some versions say they were indignant, thoroughly disgusted with the two brothers. So Jesus got them together and he settled things down. He said, okay, hey, look, okay. Let's talk about this. He was going to set them straight. He said, you've observed how godless rulers throw their weight around, how quickly a little power goes to their heads. It's not going to be that way with you. Whoever wants to be great must become a servant. Whoever wants to be first among you must be your slave. That is what the Son of Man has done. He came to serve, not be served, and then to give away his life in exchange for the many who are held hostage. Here's my first worship principle. Worship is serving. It was Pastor Dez, I think, who spoke a lot about the inverted pyramid, that those who are pastors and leaders serve from the bottom, because that's what the kingdom is. We come to serve. We're not here to be in places of high power. I'm very grateful that the board put trust in me and Dr. Marty in this season to lead in an interim capacity. But I want to be very clear, we didn't come to lead, and I think I can speak for Dr. Marty, we didn't come to lead so everyone will follow us and we can do whatever. We've come to serve. We are the lead servants in this house, and we're here to serve. And that is what the kingdom is all about, and worship comes forth, and it is an act of worship when you serve, when you get this. Not to be served, but to serve. Can you imagine what they must have thought of those couple of guys? What, James and John. Can you imagine? I mean, they already get to do all the good stuff, and here they want to be on his left and right, but I think we can be like that. I think I can be like that. I don't always get it right. Want a position of authority or power, or I want to be recognized, but really we've come to serve. So here they are. They're walking toward Jerusalem, and Jesus gives them this great lesson. Then we're going to move over into Mark. They spent some time in Jericho. They're walking along now this journey. And some believe that there were two Jerichos, a historic Jericho and a modern day Jericho. I don't know. I just think best I can tell, they were making their way into Jericho when this happened, and it was on the outskirts of Jericho. And as they were leaving town, Jesus was walking ahead of his disciples. Now, interestingly here, Jesus is a wanted man, and there have been other times that he has pulled back a bit, but not this time. Jesus is walking in front of his disciples. He's leading the way. He's a man on a mission. He's got a purpose. He's walking forward. And it says, as Jesus was leaving town, trailed by his disciples in a parade of people, a blind beggar by the name of Bartimaeus was sitting alongside the road. And when he heard that Jesus of the Nazarene was passing by, he began to cry out, "Son of David, Jesus, mercy, have mercy on me." Many tried to hush him up, but he yelled all the louder, "Son of David, mercy, have mercy on me." I want you to think about this picture now. Jesus walking confidently, maybe teaching along the way. He's just given the disciples, he's put them in their place. And they're walking, and the crowd's growing, and it's gathering, and it's a lot of people trying to make their way through these small roads. And over to the side is Bartimaeus and his friend, and they're yelling, "Son of David, have mercy." People, shh, let him go. Shh. We don't have time for, let him go. Let him go through. Be quiet. But he yells all the louder, "Jesus, have mercy, Son of David." And I love this. Jesus stopped in his tracks. Call him over. Here's the number two worship principle. Worship is recognizing who Jesus is. When he called to the Son of David, that was a very specific call. It was a messianic realization that Jesus is not just a good man. He's not just a prophet. He's not just one that's performed some signs. He is the Son of David. He is the King. He is the Messiah. That's what worship is, recognizing who he is. Recognizing that that's not me. I'm not king of the universe. He is the king. That's worship, simply recognizing. That's what Bartimaeus did. And so they called over to him. So the ones who had been telling them, hey, be quiet. We're trying to make progress here. We're on a time schedule. We're trying to get to Jerusalem. Be quiet. Don't bother him. Suddenly they have to say, okay, all right, come on over. It's your lucky day. Get up. He's calling you to come. And throwing off his coat, he was on his feet at once and came to Jesus. And Jesus said, what can I do for you? The blind man said, Rabbi, I want to see. I want to see. My guess is that he said that from a place of great faith. He had already recognized who Jesus is, and now he's expressing that faith, and he says, Rabbi, I want to see. On your way, said Jesus, your faith has saved you and healed you. And in that very instant, he recovered his sight and followed Jesus down the road. He joined the group of praisers. Third worship principle, worship is having faith. It's why so often I say to you, or I sing to you in times of worship, I'll say, sing it with faith. Sing it from a place of faith. You can't come in here on a Sunday morning dealing with things in your life, dealing with issues, whether they're medical issues or relational issues, or you got something going on at work. You can't come in here and say, nothing is impossible for you, unless you're activating your faith. That's what you're doing in that moment. You're activating your faith. Who am I to deny what the Lord can do? Those are all moments and songs of faith. And worship is just having faith. That's an act of worship. Anybody, is it just me, or sometimes your faith is weak a little bit? But we can activate that. And that's worship. So they're on the road. They're here in Jericho. They begin to move throughout the city. And I'm going to come over to Luke, where we see that Jesus entered, that we've made our way all the way from Salome trying to get the mama's boys something from Jesus. I mean, maybe she will. I don't know. I don't even know where that came from. Maybe. Clearly, they couldn't go ask for themselves. They sent Mama to do it. And they make their way into Jericho. He heals Bartimaeus, and they keep walking. They're in Jericho, and it says Jesus entered and walked through Jericho. He's walking. There's a man there named Zacchaeus, the head tax man. He was quite rich. He desperately wanted to see Jesus. He desperately wanted to see Jesus. He desperately wanted to see Jesus. But the crowd was in his way. He was a short man and couldn't see over the crowd. Zacchaeus was a wee little man. I still hear you. And he said, Zacchaeus, you come down. He ran ahead and climbed up in a sycamore tree so he could see Jesus when he came by. And I can just imagine that by now he's healed Lazarus. The crowd is growing. It's become quite the group. He's healed Lazarus. He's walked through. He's having these conversations. He comes and he heals Bartimaeus and his buddy. And as he's walking, the crowds are growing and they're pressing in. I can imagine Jesus and his disciples feeling pretty crowded. And people are all around just wanting to hear. They're straining to hear what this man is saying, what this rabbi is saying, what this miracle worker is saying. They want to get a glimpse of him, and they want to see him. And so they're taking the journey down the road, and Zacchaeus is back here. trying, just wanting to see him. And he's walking, he's trying to probably press through the, can I get through the crowds and people are, no. They're, hey, and by the way, he's not a very well-liked character. He's the lead tax man. He's probably bamboozled all of them out of money at some point. And so he's trying to make his way through. Have you ever tried to merge on 820? I saw a bumper sticker yesterday. We were in front, there was a car in front of us, and it said, please let me merge before I start crying. That's what it said. I imagine Zacchaeus was trying to merge into the lane of all of those people who are just walking to Jesus, and he's jumping up and down. So he climbs up in this tree. He climbs up in the tree because he wants to be able to see Jesus. He desperately wanted to see Jesus. So he gets up from that lofty position and he's watching. Worship point number four. Worship is fixing your eyes on Jesus. It's that simple. It's fixing your eyes on Jesus. And can I just tell you, I've had to remind myself of that a whole lot over the last few weeks. I'm just being honest. But here's what I found. When we hold on to Jesus, when we put aside the obstacles, when we put aside the distractions, when we don't worry about the people trying to elbow us out, when we just fix our eyes on Jesus, things just seem to change. It's just something about it. Things just seem to change. Suddenly, that problem just doesn't seem so big after all. Suddenly, that thing, that crisis that you're dealing with, it just doesn't seem so big after all. Perspective is a funny thing. But fixing our eyes on Jesus, we recognize who he is. And that's worship. It's just simply fixing our eyes on Jesus. So Jesus, I don't know if he noticed the commotion. I don't know if maybe it had become a little commotion because this guy has literally climbed up in a tree and people are pointing and laughing. And I don't know if Jesus is walking and he kind of notices. Maybe it was like the woman with the issue of blood. He just felt something in that moment. Maybe it was like that and he stopped. And he looks up into the tree and he says, Zacchaeus, hurry down. Today is my day to be a guest in your home. Zacchaeus scrambled out of the tree, hardly believing his good luck, and delighted to take Jesus home with him. Everyone who saw the incident was indignant and grumped. What business does he have getting cozy with this crook? We've walked with him all the way from Lazarus' tomb to hear the sons of Zebedee try to take power. We've been with him all this way. And you're going to this guy's house? Going to Zacchaeus' house? Zacchaeus stood there. He was a little stunned. He stammered apologetically, Master, I give away half of my income to the poor. And if I'm caught cheating, I pay four times the damages. And Jesus just said, today is salvation day in this home. Here he is. Here he is. Jesus is now presenting him to the crowd. Here he is, Zacchaeus, son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to find and restore the lost. Hallelujah. So, Jesus goes to Zacchaeus' house. I don't know. Did they have dinner? Did they sit and talk and tell stories? I don't know. But I know that Zacchaeus fixed his eyes on Jesus, and it changed his life. So Jesus and his group, they continue to walk. And the scripture says, while he had their attention, and because they were getting close to Jerusalem by this time, and expectation was building that God's kingdom would appear any minute, he told this story. I'm on point number five, if you're counting. I'm about halfway through. And my time is looking good. Don't get nervous. I believe I'm going to hit all 10 of these today. He said, there was once a man descended from a royal house who needed to make a long trip back to headquarters to get authorization for his rule and then return. Now, that sounds very familiar. But first, he called 10 servants together. He gave them each a sum of money and instructed them, operate with this until I return. But the citizens there hated him. So they sent a commission with a signed petition to oppose his rule. Oh, here comes the crowd. We don't want this man to rule us. When he came back bringing the authorization of his rule, he called those 10 servants to whom he had given the money to find out how they had done. And they said, Master, I doubled your money. That's the first. He said, Master, I doubled your money. He said, good servant, great work. Because you've been trustworthy in this small job, I'm making you governor of 10 towns. Second one said, Master, I made a 50% profit on your money. He said, I'm putting you in charge of 5 towns. The next servant said, Master, here's your money safe and sound. I kept it hidden in the cellar. To tell you the truth, I was a little afraid. I know you have high standards and you hate sloppiness and don't suffer fools gladly. He said, you're right that I don't suffer fools gladly, and you've acted the fool. Why didn't you at least invest the money in security so I would have gotten a little interest on it? Then he said to those standing there, take the money from him and give it to the servant who doubled my stake. And they said, but Master, he already has the double. And he said, that's what I mean. Risk your life and get more than you ever dreamed of. Play it safe and end up holding the bag. As for these enemies of mine who petitioned against my rule, clear them out of here. I don't want to see their faces around here again. Worship point number 5. Worship is investing. Worship is giving. Now, I'm one who has given my life and my talents to investing them in the kingdom. As a musician, as a singer, I've given my life to the church. I did try out for American Idol once. I did. I didn't make it. Janice and I sat up all night. I did not plan to tell this. In fact, I've not even thought about it until this moment. But we were living in Tennessee and we drove to Birmingham, Alabama and went to American Idol. It was the worst experience ever. But we had fun in Birmingham. And I mean, who knows, you know, but the truth is there's been a call in my life since I was 13 to be involved in music ministry and church. And so I've given that. But I look around this room today and I see lots of you who are giving and investing into the kingdom. I see people with the gift of hospitality. You have a wonderful smile. You have a great firm high five and handshake, and you welcome people in these doors. I see people standing in the parking lot helping direct cars because our parking lot's pretty full most weeks. I see people holding babies. I see choir members singing. I see teachers giving their gifts. That's investing into the kingdom. That's using your gifts into the kingdom. And I just want to encourage you today, if you have a gift and you're not using it, start. Find a place of service. Please don't come in here and sit on these pews on Sunday and walk out and never think about the church again. Don't come sit in here and enjoy all of the great music and worship and throw your hands on there, but not find a place to pick up the plow and get on the journey with us. Invest. And I debated whether I should even say this because I don't want it to come across the wrong way and I don't want it to feel like I'm stepping on your toes, but I remember in our first few years in ministry, Janice and I were serving as teachers in Vacation Bible School. And we had a hard time. This is when we were living in Tennessee. We had a hard time finding teachers. And what we noticed was something very interesting. All of the school teachers did not sign up to teach in Vacation Bible School. And it made perfect sense when we'd approach them. They'd say, look, I teach kids 7 months out of the year. I sure ain't doing it in July. I'm taking a break. And I can totally understand that. I get it. And at the same time, can I just tell you, if you've been gifted to teach and you're using it everywhere else, now listen. I want to be very careful about this. Using your gifts to teach children, whether you are in public school, whether you're teaching in private school, wherever you are in full-time ministry. There is no doubt about it. No doubt about that. You are using your gifts in the kingdom. Absolutely, 100%. You are using your gifts. That is true. And I love you, and I praise you, and I thank you for what you're doing unto the Lord Jesus. And I will add, we also need you here. And that doesn't mean that you have to teach Sunday school every week. It doesn't mean, but this house also needs your help. And I say this from a place of being the one that has to often help find greeters and ushers and parking lot attendants and the nursery workers. We don't ever have enough people. We just don't. And so I would just say, find something to do. If you have gifts, use them in this house as well. I truly believe this. I believe God will give you the energy. I believe God will restore to you what you do to, and when you invest in that way. I really believe that. I pray it over the choir every Wednesday night. They race across the Metroplex to get here, to be here at 6:30. They do it every single week. They serve faithfully, even when they're tired, even when they got stuff going on, but they make it here. As many people as you see sitting in the choir loft on a Sunday, almost every Wednesday, I have more in rehearsal than I do in the choir loft because they're faithful and they give. And I do believe God will restore back to them the time, the energy that they put into that. And so I would just say, help us here too. We need you. Okay. I didn't mean to get into all that. So here's Jesus. He's giving this parable. And they're continuing to walk on the road. Now, at this time, they're making it through. I'm assuming that maybe Jesus is saying this while they're walking. I don't know. I don't know if he pulled them off to the side and told them the story. But they're making their way on this journey, and they pull into Bethany. They're back at Lazarus' house. Mary's house and Martha's house. And this says, 6 days before Passover, Jesus entered Bethany, where Lazarus, so recently raised from the dead, was living. Lazarus and his sisters invited Jesus to dinner at their home. Martha served. Lazarus was one of those sitting at the table with them. Mary came in with a jar of very expensive aromatic oils, anointed and massaged Jesus' feet, and then wiped them with her hair. The fragrance of the oils filled the house. And I can just imagine her kneeling down there, breaking off the top of that bottle of perfume, just beginning to pour it out on Jesus' feet. It says, Judas Iscariot, one of his disciples, even then getting ready to betray him, said, "Why wasn't this oil sold? And the money given to the poor, it would have easily brought 300 silver pieces." Now, a denarius was equal to about a day's wage. So 300 would have been quite a sum of money. The average worker in the United States makes $228 a day, assuming a 5-day work week, 40 hours a week. $228 a day. So if we multiply that by 300, it's probably about $68,000 is what this bottle is worth. It would have been an investment. And she kneels down and she breaks it open and she begins to anoint his feet. Worship principle number 6. Worship should cost you something. It was David who was told by the Lord to go get the field, the threshing floor, where Arana was working. And so he went and approached Arana, and Arana told him, "You can have it, take it, my king, absolutely take it. Build an altar here. Take all the animals too. I give it all to you." And David said, "Nope, I don't think so." He said, "I'm gonna pay you for that exactly what it's worth, because I will not give to the Lord that which costs me nothing." So when you give costly things, that's an act of worship. So Judas is scoffing and mocking, and The scripture says that he said all of this not because he cared 2 cents about the poor, but because he was a thief. He was in charge of the common funds, but had also embezzled them. Jesus said, "Let her alone. She's anticipating and honoring the day of my burial. You'll always have the poor with you, but you won't always have me." Let me just say too, this is not a point, but it is a point. Sometimes when you're worshiping, you just have to ignore the haters. Just ignore the haters. Break open the jar of perfume. Break it open. Pour it out. Just ignore the haters. So word got out among the Jews that he was back in town. The people came to take a look, not only at Jesus, but also at Lazarus, who had been raised from the dead. So the high priest plotted to kill Lazarus because so many of the Jews were going over and believing in Jesus on account of him. Now, I think maybe they spent the night there and got up the next morning. I'm unsure if they went, if this is the very next thing they did, or if it was the next day. But either way, Jesus neared Jerusalem, having arrived at Bethpage on Mount Olives, and he sent 2 disciples with these instructions: "Go over to the village across from you. You'll find a donkey tethered there, her colt with her." Now, Matthew's the only one that mentions the mother. But he says, "You're going to find a donkey tethered there, her colt with her. Untie her, bring them to me. If anyone asks what you're doing, say, 'The master needs them.' He will send them with you." This is the full story of what was sketched earlier by the prophet. They're quoting Zechariah 9. "Tell Zion's daughter, 'Look, your king's on the way, poised and ready, mounted on a donkey, on a colt, foal of a pack animal.'" The disciples went and did exactly what Jesus told them to do. They led the donkey and the colt out. They laid some of their clothes on them, and Jesus mounted. Here's worship point number 7. Worship includes everyone. Now you may go, okay, what in the world does that mean? Well, here's what I think it may mean. There was a reason that Jesus came on a colt, on a donkey. He was coming in peace. But that young colt was unbroken, had never been ridden. And I think, Dr. Marty and I were talking about this week, I think it's possible that the mother went along because that great crowd that was growing as Jesus was walking and as they began to do what we're going to talk about next with these palm branches, that young animal would have been scared to death. Now, I know the Messiah is riding him, and there is peace where the Messiah is, but I think maybe that mother came along to help encourage her young colt to go on. And we talked about this. How important is it that those of us who are more experienced, who have been through more things, will come alongside the younger who are carrying the Messiah, who are carrying the word of the Lord? Because here's the deal. I don't care if you're young and you're sitting in that balcony this morning, or if you're, you know, you're 15, 14, 17, 18, you can carry the word of the Lord just like those who are 40, 50, 60, 70. So this young donkey is carrying Jesus. And I would just say worship includes everyone. It includes the older generation. It includes the younger generation. And it's them walking side by side. So if you're old in this house today, don't despise the young. Listen to them. They can have a fresh word from the Lord. If you're young, take the wisdom of the older ones who are walking beside you. And let's walk that together. Oh, I've got to move on. So Jesus mounts on this young, unridden donkey, this colt, and starts riding into Jerusalem. And it says, right at the crest where the Mount of Olives begins its descent, the whole crowd of disciples burst into enthusiastic praise over all the mighty works they had witnessed. "Blessed is he who comes in the King in God's name. All's well in heaven. Glory in the high places." Some Pharisees from the crowd told him, "Teacher, get your disciples under control." But he said, "If they keep quiet, the stones would do it for them, shouting praise." And I just got to ask, have you ever seen a rock praise? I mean, rocks don't have lips. They don't have teeth. They don't have a tongue. They don't have vocal cords. How can a rock praise? I don't know what that would have sounded like. Would it have been like a great earthquake? Would it have been an audible voice? I don't know, but I got to tell you this. As long as I'm breathing, I've got a reason to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, praise the Lord. Oh, my soul, I won't keep quiet. My God is alive. How can I keep it inside? I've got to praise the Lord. Oh, my soul. Worship point number 8. Worship is exuberant praise. It's exuberant praise. I will not let the... As far as I'm concerned, I won't know what it sounds like if a rock cries out. I don't even care. We're not going to get there. I'm going to give him my praise. I'm going to walk into this house on a Sunday morning, and I'm going to lift my hands in the air, and I'm going to say, praise the Lord, no matter where I've been the night before, or no matter where I'm going, or no matter what I think the people around me who are scoffing and saying, well, you know, why don't they just shut up? Why doesn't he just be quiet? I mean, you might have somebody that say, they are literally tone deaf. Why doesn't he just sing a little bit quieter over there? No, no, no. Worship is exuberant praise. It's giving him all of that. It's lifting our voice. It's lifting our gaze. It's making that sound. No, I won't let the rocks cry out in my place. Whew. So Jesus is riding through, and I'm coming to a close, I promise. Jesus is riding through on this donkey, and he weeps over Jerusalem. He weeps. Now imagine this. The crowd is bursting at the seams with 2.5 million people there. The Pharisees are perched up from their window wondering what's going on here. They even confront him. Tell them to be quiet. Jesus says the rocks are going to cry out, and people are waving branches, and they're putting them in the road. They're taking off their coats, and they're laying it down before Jesus as he rides over, and Jesus weeps over Jerusalem because he says, you've missed it. You've totally missed it. You didn't get it. And so Jesus, weeping, returns, I believe, to Bethany that night, and then the next day, he gets up and walks with the disciples. And he was hungry, it says. Off in the distance, he saw a fig tree in full leaf. He came up on it, expecting to find something for breakfast. Well, the tree was in full leaf after all. But nothing was there but fig leaves. It wasn't yet the season for figs. He addressed the tree, and he said, no one is going to eat fruit from you again ever. And the disciples overheard him. Worship point number 9, worship produces fruit. And I'm going to start with the fruits of the Spirit. When you worship, it should be producing something in you. Love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. If you worship Jesus like that and it's not producing in you some kindness, if you worship Jesus like that, it's not producing in you some self-control, then go back to the first of the list and let's talk about serving and let's talk about fixing our eyes on Jesus and let's talk about all of that. Let's start getting those things in line. It should be producing something in us. And then Jesus, after cursing the fig tree, he goes in the temple and he just begins to literally throw the tables. He starts going and ripping the sheets off the tables. I can see coins flying, just going everywhere. Pigeons, doves just going. It's complete chaos. He throws over the table and he says, my house is a house of prayer. My house is a house of prayer, but you've made it a den of thieves. And here's what I think, and we know this, that the sellers had come in to provide sacrifices. They had come in to sell, because all those people that are traveling, it would have been hard to also come with sacrifices, so it's just convenient. I'll just get to the temple and buy one. But by the way, worship should cost you something. And I don't mean just throwing some money down for a dove, but worship should cost you something. But it was more convenient to go pick those up at the temple. And it said that Jesus drove out the sellers and the buyers. Both. And what I would say is, number 10, worship should be pure. Pure worship. Costly worship. That's what worship should be. This should be a house of prayer for the nations. And you know what? I think sometimes we've just gotten too good at church. We don't even need Jesus. In fact, it's almost better without him here. Because we don't have to live all those things. We don't have to live in a place of serving. That's not fun. You don't have to live in a place of self-control. That's not fun. I'd rather tell them what I think. I'm going to give them a piece of my mind. That doesn't sound like fruits of the Spirit. And we've just programmed church to where we can show up and he's not even here, not even notice it. But true worship is pure worship. It's pure worship. It's costly worship. And so I would say if you go from point number 1 all the way through number 10, you will see exactly what that first Palm Sunday was meant to tell us. And it's this: this whole kingdom thing is a whole lot different than what you think. Jesus was nothing that they were expecting. And he was everything that they weren't expecting. It was all upside down. He was turning things upside down. But when we do that, when we serve, that's upside down from the world's values. When we recognize who Jesus is, when we have faith, when we turn our eyes upon Jesus, when we serve him and him alone, when we break open that jar of costly anointing oil and begin to anoint him, whatever that might be in your life, when we produce fruit, when our worship is pure, all of those things, when we worship together, that is pure worship. And it's a whole lot different than what the world would say is important. But it's what's important in the kingdom. That's worship fit for the King. Will you stand with me? I know I've gone over, but as the worship team and band comes, we're going to sing as we go. I'm going to dismiss you, but I am going to also open the altars and just say, if this morning you say, you know what, I've missed it. I've missed it. I've blown it. That's okay. You still need to throw your hands in the air and give him your exuberant praise. It's okay. You may say, I don't even know this Jesus. Well, today's your day. It could be a wonderful moment for you to meet Jesus, to accept him, to recognize who he is, the Messiah, the King, the Savior. So I'm going to open. We're going to sing. If you need to slip out, do that. If you want to meet Jesus, I'm going to be standing right here along with Dr. Marty, Pastor Josh, Pastor Daniel, Rhonda, we're going to be right here. If you want to meet Jesus, you come down here and shake our hands. We'll spend a moment with you. If you want to come pray, you come pray. Lord Jesus, I thank you for your word. I thank you for your life. I thank you for this week that we have to reflect on who you are and how you came to turn everything upside down. And Jesus, I just pray today that you will help us, remind us what is important. Fixing our eyes on you, recognizing who you are, giving our costly gifts, giving you our praise. Help us. We love you, Jesus. We worship you, we adore you. And everybody said, amen. 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 God bless you. Go in peace this week.
Mm-hmm.